is one other power talk with Archana, United Nations Women. United Nations Women is a UN organization dedicated to gender equality and empowerment of women. A global champion for women and girls, it stands behind women's equal participation in all aspects of life, focusing on five priority areas: increasing women's leadership and participation, ending violence against women, enhancing women's economic empowerment, and making gender equality central to national and development planning budgeting. I have with me the true ambassador of United Nations Women, Ms. Nishtha Satyam. Ms. Nishtha Satyam is the Deputy Country Representative, UN Women, spearheading UN Women's engagement with traditional and non-traditional partners across India, Bhutan, Maldives, and Sri Lanka. She principally focuses on developing and implementing strategies. Under her leadership, the program has expanded presence to frontier areas, including women's peace and security, disaster risk management, second chance education, cyber crime, and women's access to sustainable, decentralized, renewable energy. She is more than a feminist. Let's find out from this angel what she has in store for women across the globe. Hello, Ms. Nishtha, how are you doing today?
I am wonderful, I'm feeling well, and I hope you are too.
Absolutely. So, Nishtha, you know, we all have been talking about gender equality, and it is quite at the core of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And you yourself have been working as the right arm of UN Women representing Asia Pacific as the deputy representative for the past few years. Now, this global movement is indeed creating waves. We definitely understand that the percentage of women entrepreneurs need to grow and grow many folds, and we are definitely getting her ready to take that charge. But don't you feel that we need to work on changing the face of the offices that she goes to, even if it is virtual now? The quality of ecosystem around her, the entrepreneurial ecosystem around her, needs to be more thriving, maybe more conducive, maybe more inviting and more comfortable environment for her to work, knowing that, yes, we are in the VUCA world, everything is going virtual. What are your thoughts there?
So, of course, I don't think it is a matter of debate whether the world needs to open really the doors for women to walk in. But, you know, the notion that women only walk into CSEC, into boardrooms and into formal places like we do is also not probably very representative of the country that we live in. Women walk in into all informal kinds of work. Women take back work in rural areas, in urban areas. Women work in factories, women work as contract laborers, women work in boardrooms. 93% to almost 97% of our workforce in India is informal, and a large number of that is women. So let's first reconsider, you know, our notion, which is yours and mine, of work itself. So work as it looks for me and you is not how work looks for a very large part of this country. Okay. And so let's first recognize these women. And I think that's the first step, because if you don't visibilize all these women, because they're all invisible workers, right? They don't show up in policies, they don't show up on the employees' accounts, they don't show up in formal contracts. So the first step really is to welcome women, is to acknowledge them, is to first understand and realize and that they exist as workers in the economy, as people who participate in the economy. And to me, the visibilization of women as workers and their world of work is probably the first step towards a long spectrum of things that we are speaking about. Yeah. Now, do we need to do more to make women feel, to make the environment more conducive, to make them feel more welcomed, to make them feel more appreciated, right? Now, yeah. Absolutely. Now, this, I think, is not a matter of debate at all. So I wouldn't have an opinion that would be otherwise. I think we all at a moment in time agree that it's high time that while we're looking at breaking the glass ceilings, the doors from the insides need to be opened for women. And women on the shop floor, women in mid-management, women in senior management. And as you actually go through the economic pyramid of the country, you actually see you see the invisibilization of women at almost every single level. But when we say welcomed, you know, so the only problem with the word that I have welcomed is, you know, in our context, in our cultural context, welcome almost sounds like, you know, you're standing with two garlands and you're kind of, you're hospitable and you're nice and you're, you know, you have this whole drum roll to welcome someone. So I do have a problem with the use of the word welcome here, because I don't think that is what women are expecting. I'm sure even if it was about you, Archana, or me, I don't think we ever hoped for a drum roll dance for us to just to be at work. I think what we're expecting is far more than the word welcome. I think we're looking for equal opportunities. We're looking for unbiased work environments. We're looking for zero sexual harassment environments. We're looking for an environment where a woman doesn't have to particularly think and choose between things that she has to go through biologically versus growth. We're looking at an environment where women do not have hidden costs to pay for what companies are anyway responsible to provide, but are providing and positioning as benefits. We are looking at an environment where there's equal pay for equal work and equal recognition. And we're looking at a world, probably, where if a man has a child, then it doesn't occur to anybody that he may not be a great source of investment thus after. So essentially what we're looking at is opening the doors, opening the shutters of your own brain that has been conditioned over a period of time to treat women as equal human beings. And I think to me, that sounds very basic and very obvious. But you know, patriarchy is also the oldest institution of the world. Yeah. So it's not as obvious as you and I are making it to be. But what I do definitely know is, after having worked with women for a very, very long time, is we are not looking for privileges. We are neither looking for privileges and neither are we looking for immunity. I think we're looking for an equal playing field, which is a very just ask. And so maybe we're not probably looking at a welcome, but we're definitely looking at the opening of the doors inside and not just breaking the glass ceilings. So I think a lot needs to be done and I think a lot is being done. But what I do definitely think from a macroeconomic framework is that, and I do want to insist on this, is when people like you and I talk, it's very important that we reflect on the reality of this country, that we imagine work to be what work is actually on the ground, is to realize that you and me are very privileged people to be sitting where we are. And women don't work for exactly the same reasons that we do. And women don't exactly stay back for reasons that we probably do. And so I think there is this need from a macroeconomic perspective to redefine work environments, and to redefine the world of work in how women relate to it. And so I would start with visibilizing the contribution of women. And I keep saying that you can go through all the farmlands of India and you'll always spot women doing something on the land, but they're never on policy. Today, you see the entire farmers' agitation. There's not a single woman to be seen, but 80% of agricultural labor is women. Today, we keep talking about the healthcare force, but 70% of the world's healthcare force is women. But who's talking about them?
Absolutely.
So visibilize them before we make them feel welcomed. I think we're far, far behind from where your question started.
No, I think you're quite right. You have given it the right direction, Nishtha. Absolutely right. In fact, I feel this is just the tip of the iceberg. When we talk about policies, we talk about enablers, we talk about cultural and behavioral changes at different levels. But then I think it's just on papers. We need to get going and we need to have, you know, it's, you know, making policies is different, but the execution is very, very different. So, you know, when we talk of, you know, execution of the policies that we put together for women to come in focus, for women to be, you know, treated as equal, you know, as men. So what are your thoughts there? I mean, how do you think we can really bridge this gap? Because there is indeed a big gap there. How do you think we can work on this?
I think the way to treat women equal is to treat them equal. There is no magic pill. There is no shortcut. There is no proxy, and there is no alternate way of making someone feel equal without treating them like equal. Yeah. Right. And I think to me, that's the starting point and that's the end point. It's not an easy task because it is about the redistribution of power. So I think, you know, essentially we all need to talk about what is the problem with equality? How can half the world have a problem with equality, or so many people have a problem with equality? Because it questions the redistribution of power, right? It takes away power from somebody who has it. It takes away franchise from somebody who has it and then redistributes it. Of course, it's not a pleasant process. It's not a happy process. I'd be very unhappy if somebody took power out and redistributed it. So fundamentally, I think there is this, there needs to be an acknowledgement that we're not talking about a very pleasant process. We're not talking about ice cream that's going to make everybody happy. This is a difficult process. It is many, many years of grooming and conditioning. But the one thing I can tell you is there is no way to work towards equality if there's without working towards equality, right? So the way to work on equality is to give women equality. It's the easiest way. It's the most sure-shot way. And there are no shortcuts to getting there. But what I do realize that ensuring that women are equal partakers in society, in marketplaces and communities is also a process. And I think equity is that process. Equality could be that goal, but equity is the process that that one wants to take. And if you look at what essentially equity means, and I'm sure all of us have seen that picture somewhere where there are different three people trying to reach the tree or the fruit, they're all of different heights, and the shortest one gets the highest pedestal so that he can reach the fruit, right?
Yeah.
So you know, we have to look at equality through the process of equity, right? Which is a race can be run only by two people when they have the same starting point. You can't have two people run the race when one's far behind. And so merit is not a conversation between two people who don't have the same starting points or who don't have the same circumstances. So to me, I think we need to give women the same starting point, and that does mean investing in the agenda of women's empowerment in an intentional and targeted way. That could be through union budgets, that could be through state policy and programs, that could be through campaigns, that could be through citizen awareness. And there are a lot of things that we will need to do to get there. But what we definitely need to do is to get women to a point where they can pluck the fruit by themselves and they're not standing on a different height. So, and then we can have all the conversations on equality, but equity is the process. I think we're still in the process, and we may need to pay attention to that.
Yeah, I think you're quite right there. We definitely need to work in that area, because after all, it's all said and done with. It's important to treat women with respect. And as you very rightly said, we need to have a certain level of budgeting to ensure, and we need to invest in women empowerment, women equality and gender equality to get that kind of focus. Absolutely right. So tell me, ma'am, I mean, you know, we are in a VUCA world right now. We are in a state where, you know, things have gone virtual. With restricted movement, how do you think, the pandemic has really affected the life of women, the marginalized women? And
honestly, I think whether it be this pandemic or whether it be any disaster, the character of any disaster and any pandemic and any epidemic is to marginalize those who are already at the margins, right? And I think it has been quite obvious on how it's impacted women and their lives. You see a lot of the contract labor or the first to suffer are people who do not have formal terms of employment. And it really affects people and a lot of women fall into that bracket. You see there's been a surge in domestic violence across, even in the first 10 days of the lockdown. You see, we're already hearing of women of girls who are being pulled out of school because of no access to the internet, or you know, the school's not functioning now almost for a year. So what does it mean for a woman to know, for a girl to be pulled out of school? Unlike men, women do live a life cycle approach, right? It's an integrated, intersectional way of how problems play out. So dropping out of school would mean early marriage would mean early pregnancy would mean ill health. Ill health is basically bad health for the rest of her life, leading to more financial shocks. So you see, in women's lives, one leads to another, leads to another, leads to another. So of course, I think the pandemic has pushed millions into poverty. The pandemic has pushed millions back into the life cycle, any of these, the ones that I spoke about, back into that life cycle. And the dread here really is that women will go, the lives of women will spiral downwards. You know, a very interesting analysis of Ebola tells us that only 50% of women came back to where they were before the pandemic.
True.
And for those who did come back, they almost took twice the time as men did. So of course, you know, when the world, you know, it's basically, if I were to give you an analogy, like I always keep saying, if you're not on the table, you're on the menu. Here, we are talking about a situation where the very size of the table has shrunk. And of course, you know, the world has this very uncanny way of giving men the preference. Men, like they say, are born with a natural reservation. And in a situation like this, where the size of the table has shrunk, I think the only change that can save us from the disaster that we're looking at is when governments will come together, and when people like you and I will come together and say that we will need to intentionally focus on women. And this is not going to happen accidentally. This is not going to happen trickle down. This is only going to happen if we say we have to save the women first. Otherwise, they will get left out.
Yeah, I think you are quite right. They will definitely get left out if this is not taken care of and not paid attention to right away. As I always say, this is the time, and this is the time to act now. We don't have time to, you know, sulk over it or keep thinking about it. Very right. Tell me one thing, Nishtha, you know, you have been, you know, giving smiles to so many people, so many women out there who smile because of the endeavors that, you know, you put across into different kind of policies, different kind of strategies. You strategize for them and you make them happy. You make them feel worthwhile. What is that one thing that makes you smile?
I think it's a little too embellished a description of what I do. And I do think it's a little, it's a great over-exaggeration of what I have been able to achieve professionally. I don't think there's anybody in the world who smiles because of me. But the one thing that I can tell you is there are a lot of people because of whom I smile. And a lot of those stories come from the women that we work with. Because, you know, honestly, as much as even at a personal level, as much as strength and valor I have shown in my life, when I meet women from rural India, I'm surprised by the guts. I'm surprised just by their sheer guts, by their sheer courage, by their sheer valor. And that's what I keep telling even my family, that, you know, people like me who, you know, when they're distressed, we look distressed. You know, if 2 days in my life didn't go well, you'd be able to look at me the third day and say, well, there's something wrong. You know, you're not wearing your kajal, you're not looking your usual self, and you're not sparkly and brighty and all of that. But if you were to just look at the women who come home to work with us in this country, you know, you would hardly you know, if I were to expand your imagination, I mean, just think of them, just observe them. There's not a single day where, you know, the wonderful woman who helps me at home has come without her bindi, her sari well tied, her shoes in place, her bangles in her hand. And, you know, if you get to speak to her, she probably is going through the most miserable time. that one that you could possibly think of. You know, her, she would have a story of domestic violence. She would probably be the only earning member. She's probably upset with how she gets treated at home. She gets poorly treated in the household that she's married. She has many kids who she has to feed. She's probably the last to eat. She probably has family who's elderly and sick who she has to take care of. And of course, she has nobody to help her out at home. But you wouldn't be able to guess a single thing if you were to just look at her and not speak to her. And I think that strength, that valor, that sense of confidence that you see while just walking the streets on the faces of women of this country, young and old, honestly, it gives me so much hope. I'm not sure if it brings a smile because, you know, after working in the UN for many, many years, sometimes, you know, you almost are able to guess the story behind. So it sometimes doesn't bring a smile, but it does bring me hope. It does bring me confidence. It does bring gratitude. And not for my life, but, you know, just the fact, but for their lives and the fact that look at them. I mean, oh my God, if I had that life, I would look like it. Right. But look at their strength. And I think there's so much to learn from their resistance and from their resilience. And I think that is a case in point right now, because a lot of us locked down in our homes, locked down in our rooms, we are so out of inspiration. You know, we are so out of inspiration, actually. At least in the last 9 months, I've lost a lot of inspiration without meeting people, being in those four doors. Life has changed. One is struggling to find that point of reference in your own life, to reimagine life, to keep the hope up, to keep the spirits up, to keep resilience up. And when I look at one of these women, look at any one of them on the road, you know, you see these women on the road who are literally asking you for money and they're well-dressed. They have their children in their hands and their eyes are usually sparkling more than yours. And so I think, you know, today those women are our point of reference for where we can draw our resilience from in the times that we live in.
Absolutely. Beautiful. Beautiful. Absolutely. Very well said, Nishtha. Nishtha, I'm really tempted to ask you one question. You have been handling four countries from past so many years. You have been trying to instill a dream in the hearts of these women and, you know, help them, you know, just literally break chains and, you know, come forward, live their dreams and, you know, make big in life, whatever little contribution they can, but become independent in whichever small way they want to. And, you know, something that really benefits them. What is that one thing that you found common in all these women, be it India, be it Bhutan, be it Maldives, be it Sri Lanka? What is that one thing common that you found in all of them?
I think the one thing common between women across the globe, I think there are a couple of things that are common between women across the globe. Most women, many of them, all of them, have a sense of resilience that you don't see otherwise. You just don't see it in other people, right? Most women have resilience, grit, and determination to change their circumstances. And I think they go a long, long, long way in doing that. I think the other thing that is common between women is the sheer breadth of what they can handle. Not just the width of what, not just the depth of what they can handle. I think women go through great misery in just being a woman. But I'm talking for all women, rural, urban, you, me, you know, And every single time I have spoken to another woman, every single time I have spoken to another woman, a colleague, younger, older, I have just stepped back thinking, my God, the sheer breadth, just the ability to carry that sheer breadth of issues, of people, of a share of the world, a little bit of the sky on your shoulders with grit, determination, and resilience and spirit. I think these bind women universally. I think all women almost I have met can fall into that category. They know how to rise from the depths of misery. And I think from the depths of pain. And I think they carry it organically. We've romanticized that pain a little too much in this house, in this world, and made it almost inspirational. Well, it's not. I don't think anybody deserves to go through this. But the fact that women have gone through so much with the resilience that they have, and also almost without passing that bitterness down to the rest of the world, is a great fact. I think men went to war, and women kept the world alive. So I think the fact that, you know, that women hardly pass on that misery, but do definitely pass on the grit and determination. And I think we all have a story, irrespective of where we are in the world. You speak to anybody, there will be one woman that they can relate to who'll say, my God, she pulled us through the depth of our misery, right? And I think that's binding. It's universal. Women, it's universal.
Absolutely beautiful. I think you're very right, Nishtha. Every woman has a story, and she has the courage and the grit, the determination to literally just take it off her shoulders and still keep smiling and, you know, deliver what she is bound to. Amazing. Nishtha, tell me one thing, your power words to the women today, you know, whoever is listening to you, I'm sure my audience will love taking your power words for them. What is it, that one thing? Because I would want more and more arms for Nishtha to take this movement forward, because it's not your responsibility alone. It's everybody's duty, without an invitation, to come forward and support you, be your arms, your heart, your ears, your, you know, hands to, you know, accomplish what you are on, you know, you're heading for. What is your message to them, how they can make their contribution right now, right away, from the comforts of their home? What is it that you want them to do? Please give them a wake-up call right now. We are waiting to listen to you.
Well, I don't think women need a wake-up call. I think women are very busy waking up other people. And that's why you and I are having this conversation today. You know, 10 years back, probably we probably were not even in a space. And I wasn't a feminist 10 years back. It took me quite a time in my own life to say, you know what? It's not going to go on like this. Things are going to change. And probably it's taken us time, right? So I think women are very busy waking up the rest of the world. And congratulations to all women who have taken the moral duty to do so. I think the two things that I've learned from my life is fearlessness. Because I think women for too long are groomed about what they can lose. You know, we're threatened with losing dignity. We're threatened with losing people liking us, accepting us, people respecting us being accepted socially, us being accepted culturally. We're threatened with not being the nice mother. You know, we're threatened with a sense of loss all the time. I think it's very important for women like us to stand up and say, you know what, I'm not going to fear what I will lose. I have to be fearless in this journey. The other thing that I think has worked well for me is to dream ridiculous. I think you have to get up from your dreams and say, oh, that was ridiculous. So I still go around the house saying, you know, I'm going to meet the Prime Minister of India in 2045. I have no clue. And when I run out of that, I'm like, I'm going to be the SG of the UN in 2045. And, you know, sometimes my parents and my family is like, well, how many things are you going to be in 2045? And then I come down to say, you know what, I'm going to be something in 2045, something that's ridiculous to think of right now. And most often, because of what our fear of loss, I don't think we dream ridiculous, because, you know, when we dream ridiculous, we're immediately told that it's ridiculous. We're immediately showed that it's ridiculous. And I think it's a great day in a woman's life when you get up, you dream big, you tell someone, and the other person's well, like, that's ridiculous. That's bullshit.
Yeah.
I think you're really, really on the right track. If someone's telling you that you're ridiculous or you're bullshit or you're thinking too much about yourself, then you're on the perfectly right track. And I think that has worked for me. I live by it. I say insane things. I think of insane things. And to some extent from where I started, I think I've done insane things too. And that's my go-to. That's my mantra for everybody.
Lovely, lovely. You know, like the saying, you know, when a lady wakes up in the morning, the demons should say, oh my God, holy crap, she's awake. So I think that's
I think a half your family will fall into that.
Absolutely. Love it. Love it. Thank you so much, Nishtha. Thanks a lot for sparing your valuable time and speaking to my audience. We really have wanted to have this conversation and wanted people to hear your mind and where you come from. I think this is really wonderful. Really honored to have you on my show. You've really, really added stars by coming to this show, Power Talk with Archana. Thanks a lot for gracing my show. Thanks a lot. We really wanted to hear you. Thanks a lot.
My pleasure. Thank you very much. Good luck for everybody who's hearing us. Stay safe. Wear your masks. Stay put as much as you can. And find back your imagination. Find back your inspiration. And continue. And particularly women in a situation like this, please continue to be there for each other. Because I think that's going to be very, very important. So be there for each other. Talk to a woman when you see her. Ask her your story. Tell your story to her. That's how we're going to create this ring of fire that is going to help all of us raise together. So we're not going to be able to do this alone, but we can definitely do this together. So thank you, Archana, for spending your time with me and for choosing me to have you or have me on your show. It means so much to me. And good luck to your audience. And hopefully we will all talk again and we will be safe and healthy. And so will your loved ones be. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Absolute honor. Absolute honor. Thank you so much. Wishing you a very, very good life ahead. And may all your dreams come true. You're doing a wonderful job. You're also inspired. We look up to you. We respect you. Hats off to you for the wonderful task you're doing. And you've been doing it with so much of love, resilience. And for so many years now, people break down, but you've been going strong. Thanks a lot for being there. We look up to you. You're a role model and we really want more and more women to come forward and be like Nishtha. We want to have many more Nishthas and you are a role model for them. Hats off to you. We respect you. We really respect you. All our love. All our love. Thank you. Thank you.